Hello and welcome to everybody on Cloud Fitness. So in today's video, we are going to talk about autoloader in Databricks. We are going to see what is exactly autoloader, why do we use autoloader, and how we can actually implement it in Databricks. So when we talk about autoloader, remember it is nothing but it is just a process to do incremental file loads. So you have the data lake. In your data lake, your file is arriving every day. You know, it can be arriving like every minute, it can arrive every hour, right? You might have incremental data coming in your data lake. Now, how do you process it? Autoloader is just one way to process that data. But now you already know this, that okay, it is just a process, it is just a way to process your incremental loads. Now, how is it different from your traditional loads, right? What extra features does autoloader gives you? What extra benefits does autoloader gives you, right? So when you talk about the incremental data loads. So previously, how do you used to do incremental data loads? So the very first thing is you can process, the whole load at a time. So let's say you have the incremental files coming, once in a day, or it might come two times in a day. In those cases, usually what you do is you can actually fix up one particular time. You can say, okay, at 5 p.m., right, my time zone, I just want to process all the files. So this is nothing but this is your batch process, right, where you handle incremental loads as well as a batch and you just simply process them. The other way is you might create a kind of ETL or ELT pipeline where you are just trying to manage or store the information on what file was processed last from the data lake, and when the new file arrives, you actually go ahead and you check that, okay, this is the file that I processed last time, and now I want to process the next file which has come apart from the files which I've already read. So that kind of pipeline creation also helps you to do an incremental loading. And the third thing that came up was a structured streaming, where you use structured streaming directly to do incremental loads. So these were the three traditional ways where we were trying to process incremental loads, but each of them had their own issues. For example, when you talk about one-time load, right? Now, when you have this one-time load, you know that, okay, you are processing even your incremental loads as batch and you have the delay, right? So when you talk about, when you are trying to store, the last processed file somewhere, right? And then you're trying to do a lookup when the new file has arrived. Now, in that case, again, you have an overhead of maintaining that pipeline. You have an overhead of reading that whole file, right, which might eventually even grow up with the time, and it also slows down your process. Now, similarly, when you talk about structured streaming, now here also what happens is structured streaming also ends up reading everything, right, in your data lake. So that might also slow down your process if you have too many files coming in, right, every day. So each of this has their own pros and cons. But now when you talk about autoloader, what it is trying to do, it is also trying to do incremental load, but it is trying to take best of all three points which I've mentioned here. Your autoloader can process your data one at a time. It can do that. It has the capability to do that. Your autoloader stores the last processed file. It stores that, right? It also can do the structured streaming because it actually makes use of the structured streaming. Right, so it takes the best of these three points. Now I have given you a background. Now let's actually see what autoloader is, right? In a more formal way. So when you talk about autoloader, it is just a structured streaming source, right? It provides structured streaming source called cloud file, which helps you to eventually do the incremental processing. Now, how does it help? Autoloader helps you to do incremental processing. It helps you to do that using the cloud file, which is nothing but it is a structured streaming source in the cloud, in the autoloader, named as cloud file, which helps you to do incremental loading very efficiently. As soon as your new data files arrive in the data lake, your cloud files actually helps you to process the latest data files incrementally and efficiently. Right now, whenever you have new files arriving in your storage account, you always have an option to also process the files which are already present in that directory. You can reprocess them as well. So all these options are always available. Autoloader can ingest your JSON file, your CSV file, your Parquet file, your Avro, ORC, text, and the binary file format. So even if you have your images, right, you can go ahead and use autoloader for that. I also told you that autoloader maintains the checkpoint, right? When I say the checkpoint, it actually maintains the data till where it has last read. So that is nothing but that is the checkpoint location where it maintains that what data it has already read. So it maintains that checkpoint location where it stores the data as a key value store. Now using this, it actually makes sure that your data is processed only once. Now essentially when you talk about autoloader, it has to detect your new files as they come in. Now how does it do that, right? It basically has two processes to do it: directory listing and the file notification. Directory listing is nothing but it is more of a traditional approach which we have talked about. What happens is when you have your file arriving in the data lake, using this directory listing, autoloader actually lists everything that is present in your directory, and then it kind of checks out that which is the new file and it processes it. So this is nothing but your traditional directory listing approach. And the other one is your file notification. So when I say file notification, right now, as soon as the file arrives, now instead of listing everything that is present inside the data lake, what it can do is it can actually make use of notification services offered by your cloud provider. So for example, in case of Azure, you can use Azure Event Grid, you can use Azure Queue Storage as well, right, for the messaging part. So this is nothing but you are trying to make sure that as soon as the file arrives, you have a notification service on which tells where you have queue storage in case of Azure, which actually subscribes to your notification and which directly which you can directly use to ensure that okay, your file has arrived and then you have to just process it. So that is nothing but your file notification service. Now this diagram actually shows you how both of them are actually used. So when you have a cloud storage, directly listing mode, nothing but it kind of lists all the files. And when you talk about your notification mode, it actually makes use of your notification services in your cloud provider. In case of Azure, you make use of Event Grid, and then you can have your Azure queues which actually subscribe, right, to the notification, which can actually subscribe to those notification and tell you that okay, the queue is nothing but the message, right? So this message has actually come and then you need to process that particular file. Also, if you see, it's not just the file notification and directory listing that you can use. You can also use trigger.once, which you use normally in your structured streaming as well, if you want your files to be processed only once after they have arrived. So it will start your stream, and once it has triggered the process, it will close that. So let's see, I'll actually show you right now how this file notification works, right? So let me go here to the Databricks notebook that I have. So if you see over here, right, in the notification services, how does it actually looks like? The very first thing that you need to do is you need to connect your storage account to the Databricks. Now for that, I already have a video. You can go ahead and check it. There are multiple ways to do it. So in the first statement, the first statement which I have highlighted, this is nothing but I'm just connecting my storage account over here directly, right, to the Databricks. Now after that, what actually is autoloader? So autoloader is nothing but it makes use of cloud files, right? And this is how you actually provide configurations, different configurations as per your use case. Now if you're trying to use notification, you provide these configurations because you are trying to use notification over here. Now what are these configurations? Now these configurations will vary so from your use case. So if you're trying to use notification, you have to provide it. If you're not trying to use notification, you will not provide it. So subscription ID, your connection string, because you are actually connecting to the queue, right? So the SAS token for your queue service, right, that you have to actually provide here. The file format that you're trying to use, that file format, the tenant ID, the client ID, the client secret, the resource group. Now all this comes just because you are having the queue service associated to it, right? So that all these details actually comes from your queue service. And this use notification option over here, right, this use notification option is actually telling you that hey, go ahead. When you are mentioning it as true, it is actually saying that okay, use the notifications that are coming from my queue, right? Use the notifications which are coming from my queue. Now, similarly, you also have an option that include existing files. So when you want to process, do you want to include all the existing files or not? Right, so that kind of options you can actually go ahead and provide here. There are n number of options. Now this is itself, you know, how to set it up and all. I will create a separate video on this, but now just to, you know, make your concepts a bit clear, I'm trying to show you each and everything how to actually do this. Now similarly, once you have these configurations set up, right, once you have these configurations set up, you actually start making use of the this autoloader to do incremental processing. Now how? You say spark.readstream.format. Now this dot format cloud files actually tells you that this is making use of autoloader. So autoloader is nothing but it actually makes use of cloud files format to do the incremental processing. So that is why you have to mention here dot format cloud files in all the cases. Right? Options. Now in these options you are actually providing these configurations. Right, in this option you are trying to provide these configurations because you are making use of the notification service, and then you are providing the information about your queue that you have created. Now similarly, you know, you can provide n number of options. Now I will tell you n number of options here in this video itself, but there are n number of options depending upon the different use cases. Right, recursive file lookup, right? So if you have any kind of partitioning, right, into your data frame, now in that case you can, you know, turn it on or off to make use of it. Now similarly, if you have a schema, if you are predefining the schema, you can define the predefine the schema. If you do not want to predefine the schema, you can, you know, always skip that as well. And this is nothing but your ADLS account location. Now once you do this, right, this is where you start reading your stream, and you can again use spark.writestream and you can write it anywhere, right, at any of your preferred location. So this is how you actually use the autoloader notification service as well, right? So now I'll go back to the PPT because there is a lot to it. So even when I say trigger once, right, I can say I told you that we can use trigger once as well. Now how do you use trigger once? Now I will show you the usage of trigger once. So this is how you can actually use it. So let's say you are trying to read you know, again from any input location where you want to enable autoloader, right? So let's say again the same thing, spark.readstream.format cloud file. Now this is a mandatory thing, dot option cloud file format. So format option is also a format of the file which you are trying to read, that also you need to mention. And then you are saying that okay, this is the path where I want to read from. And when you're trying to write, right, df.write, right, you are trying to specify the delta format while writing it, and then you are saying dot trigger once equal to true. Now once, what it will happen when it finds the file, it is going to run it, it is going to trigger your stream once, and then it is going to stop your stream. You also see that it has an option of checkpoint location, so this also you need to give. So when you talk about this checkpoint location, this is nothing but I told you that autoloader also keeps track of what it has read, right, in form of key value store. So similarly, this checkpoint location is nothing but it is a location where autoloader is making sure what it has read, right? So this is nothing but this is how you use your trigger once. Now similarly, when you talk about directory listing, this is the default mode, right? This is the default mode. This directory listing is nothing but it is a default mode. Whenever you enable cloud files, if you have not enabled trigger.once, if you have not enabled file notification, it automatically by default adds directory listing as the default mode. Also, this particular slide tells you when to use what. So when you have, let's say, a file which is arriving daily once or daily twice, and you are okay with the delay, you know, a bit of a delay, you can always go ahead use trigger.once. Now again, if you have, you know, very frequently arriving files within the day, it is always better to use file notification service. Similarly, when you have files arriving, right, but you do not have a lot of small files arriving too frequently, in that case you can go ahead and use directory listing method as well. So now I'll move ahead and I'll tell you few features of autoloader which are very essential to understand. So the very first is the schema evolution, right? So when, let's say, you are reading a stream, right, and then you have a new column being added, now how does your autoloader respond to it? Right, so there are multiple things that you can do. You can actually fail the stream, you can actually provide an option to fail the stream. I can actually show you I will actually show you in this particular video itself. Now similarly, you know, if you want that column to be automatically added in your schema, you can do that. If you want, you know, that okay, I don't want to fail my stream, but I want to make sure that whatever records are coming with the new schema, they go to a particular column, right? It can go to a particular column itself. So this is called schema evolution. So these features have come up with autoloader. Now for example, I will kind of show you, if you want to predefine your schema, right? If you want to predefine your schema, you can do that. If you do not want to predefine your schema, if you want the schema to be inferred from the file which is being read, that part also you can do that. You can do that. So schema inference, let me take it later on, right? So now for example, let's say you are trying to read a file. Let's say you are trying to read a JSON file from a particular location. So again, spark.read.format, cloud files, and then the schema evolution mode. So this is what you actually enable, right? So these are few options which I'm trying to explain, right? So cloud files.schema evolution mode fail on new columns. So the moment you put this thing over here, right? So the moment you put this thing over here, and then the schema, right? This read schema is nothing, but this is the schema that I have defined at the top. Right, I have defined my read schema at the top. So this read schema is nothing, but it is trying to, basically this read schema is nothing, but you know, the schema which I am trying to put into the autoloader, I'm trying to say that, okay, when you are trying to read this, just use the read schema that I have mentioned. Now, if there is anything apart which is coming from this read schema, just fail it, if a new column comes in. And then I'm also trying to do a write stream. Right, I'm trying to do a write stream, and I'm trying to provide my checkpoint location. I'm also trying to provide the location where I want to load. Right, so the moment I actually do this, what is going to happen? As soon as my file comes up with the new column, it is going to fail. It is going to fail my stream. So I ran it previously. You can actually see that it has failed, encountered unknown fields during parsing, right? So during parsing, it encountered unknown field and it failed. So I will actually create a separate video where I show the whole setup, you know, and I kind of run it and show it to you, because otherwise this video will be like really long. So this is how you can actually fail on new columns. Now also I will show you rescue data columns. So let's say, if you want to create a new column called as rescue data, right, and where you want to put the data which is actually mismatching, right, so you can put it in the rescue data column as well. Now how do you do that? Again, the same things. If you see spark.read.format cloud files, and this is the format where you are trying to use, JSON format. Now here in the schema evolution mode, right, you are using rescue now. So earlier what you were trying to use, fail on new columns, right? Here I'm just saying rescue, right? And then in the option I'm saying rescue data column. So this is the name of my column, right? So you will essentially not lose the data, but whatever has a mismatch, that will go over here, right? So this is the only change that I have done for rescuing my data column. So this is the way how you can actually do the schema evolution with the autoloader. Now when I talk about schema inference, right, schema inference is nothing but, again, let's say you do not want to specify the schema, right, let's say you do not want to specify the schema, then in that case what you can do, you can always say that, hey, when you're trying to read the file, just infer the schema from the file itself. I don't know what the schema would be. Just infer the schema. So you can always do that. If you want to store your schema somewhere and you want to use it, you can use that as well. If you want to provide schema hints, you can do that. So schema hints is nothing. So let's say you want to make sure that all the date columns will be date time, right? All the time columns should be the timestamps. So those are nothing but the schema hints. I will show you how they actually work. So schema inference. So if you see, the very first thing is predefining schema. You know, just like your normal, you know, Spark, you kind of create the struct type. Inside that, you kind of define the schema. So this read schema is the same schema which I was showing you. So this is you're predefining your schema. So the moment you predefine your schema, and you know, here I'm just saying that read my schema, right? So if you see, I am defining my schema and then I'm saying that read my schema from there, and then, you know, just read the files using the autoloader because I mentioned cloud files here, and just write it. So this is nothing but you have predefined the schema. Now functioning of this and all, I'll create a separate video again. I don't want to mix it over here. But then when you talk about schema inference, right, where you don't know the schema and you want your stream to infer the schema, right, in that case, you can actually see that you can provide an option like this. Dot option cloud files dot infer column types, that I want to infer the column types from the cloud files itself, right? And if you see cloud files dot schema location is also mentioned. Now what is this? Now this is nothing but your autoloader also using the cloud files, it tries to store the schema at this particular location, whatever you would specify, so that what happens is, even if there's a schema change or anything, it is just trying to make a history of your schema. It is trying to put whatever schema it has read at one particular place. So this particular location you have to specify, where you can actually make sure that, okay, this is the place where my schema is present, right? Autoloader is just writing my schema over there, and it is using that schema and it is trying to read the files which are coming. So this is nothing but, this is the schema inference only, and then you actually specify over here infer column types, infer the column types from the stream itself. So usually all the columns that it treats, mostly they will be string only. Now similarly, fail on new column. So this is something that I think would come from the top, right, from the schema evolution, right? Let me just put it over here. I'll just explain you. So fail on new columns. So if a new column has come and you have your schema evolution mode active, so we have already seen rescue data, right? Now similarly, this fail on new columns. So I think I have already explained this. Okay. Let's just ignore this. I have already explained you this. Okay. Anyways, I'm not going to cut this from the video, but we'll go proceed to the schema hints, right? So schema hints is also something that you can use. So schema hints, how you can use it, right? So if you do not know 100% of your schema, but you want to make sure that, okay, my event time, this particular column is always a date, you can specify it. How do you specify it? You specify it just like this, right? Spark.readStream.format cloud files dot option, right? This is the file that I'm trying to read. This is the file type I'm trying to read. And then dot option cloud files dot schema hint. Use the schema hints from the cloud files. And what hint you are providing? The hint is that event time column of my schema, of the file that I'm trying to use, that will be a date type, right? Read schema. Right. So if you want to, you know, provide any extra hint to your, read stream, you can always do that. You can always do that. So you can actually see your data frame actually had a timestamp. Right. So you can always see that if you want to provide any specific hint, you can always do that specifically on your data frame as well. So now essentially you have seen how basically an autoloader works, you know, a kind of overview. So now at least you understand what it exactly it is, what kind of changes you need to do in order to implement the autoloader. Now these changes, each and everything, failing the stream, you know, automatically evolving the schema, you know, passing the bad record to a particular column, you know, storing the schema, inferring hints, everything we are going to discuss separately in each of these videos, in each of my upcoming videos. I will also show you how to connect to the storage account, use cloud files, and, you know, try to take incremental data from the storage account, how to take, you know, the data using the queue subscription. So those kind of things, you know, in detail we will capture it, but this video was just to give a more of an overview. Now overview, but yet a good understanding. But yeah, when you talk about autoloader, it gives you a very good scalability, right? You can, you know, it is very scalable, because if you have lots of file, you can leverage, you know, different cloud services. You know, if you want to use directory listing mode, you can use that. If you don't want to go ahead with that, you can use the queue service as well. So that is a very good point that autoloader has come up with. Similarly, you know, it is cost effective in the sense that, you know, so if you are using file notification mode to detect the new incoming files, then in that case you don't need to list directly. directory. So when you don't list the directory, you reduce the cost as well as you speed up the process as well. Similarly, you know, it is easy to use, so you don't have to do anything extra, just dot option, dot format, cloud file. This is something that you have to add. Apart from that, you do not have to track your files. You do not have to create a separate pipeline to maintain the checkpointing or anything of that sort. Similarly, schema, inference and evolution, right? Even if there are schema drifts, you can actually manage it, right? I have actually shown you how you can manage schema inference and how you can even evolve your schema in case you have one column being added or even being removed. Even you have data type changes, we will see it how we can handle it. So you can handle it very well in the autoloader. So this is all about autoloader, and I hope you like this video. Do let me know in the comment section if you have any doubts, and thank you so much for being till here. But do remember to always like, share and subscribe to my channel.